Okay, so let me make three remarks about band-limited functions. First of all, from the numerical experiment, we take that the condition that we want to see a detail of size h in an image or in a signal translates into the condition that we need to be able to compute the Fourier transform of that signal or the Fourier transform of that image up to a certain limit omega, and that omega is roughly 4 over h. Next thing is the engineers have a very nice way of computing the level of detail of an imaging device. They put in a small blob, a very small blob. That small blob will appear then in the image or in the signal as a wide, that delta will appear as a wide blob like this one over here. And then they take the maximum of that blob, let's say it's 1 over here, and then they take the width of it at half the maximum, so that would be at 1/2. And so the level of detail or the resolution of that device would be defined as the width of this blob at 1/2. And that's roughly equivalent to what we've already defined. It again translates into the condition that we need to be able to compute the Fourier transform of that signal up to a certain point. And that's called full width half maximum for obvious reasons. Okay, let me also mention, and I will not go into detail, I will just use that that fact later. There's also an equivalent formulation for 2π periodic functions. F, we call it 2π periodic function, F band limited if all the Fourier coefficients vanish for fk hat of f vanish for k absolute value larger than omega. And that's perfectly in line with the equivalence for a periodic Fourier transform and analytic Fourier transform, which we established formally. Okay, now we want to go to Shannon's sampling theorem. And to do that, we go back to Poisson's formula and look at it in a little bit more detail. So this is from Poisson's formula, exactly the way I wrote it down. And now assume that we've measured f on some grid k times h. So it's any equispaced grid in Rn. Again, you might also think of just R. It doesn't make any difference. So, but since it didn't make any difference, I leave n open here. Okay, so we can compute the right-hand side over here. And to get images, of course, we want to compute individual evaluations of the Fourier transform. So the f hat over here is very nice, but we have a sum, so we can only compute a sum of Fourier transform. So that doesn't help if we want to compute individual values. However, if we now combine this with the idea of band limited, maybe there's a condition or there's a way of choosing h, the step size, in such a way that almost all of these sums that we have over here vanish because they already lie outside of the region of minus omega to omega. And since f is, if f is band limited, then these might all be zero, maybe except for one, and we can actually compute that the value of the Fourier transform at that point. And that's exactly what we're going to do. So we assume that f of k times h has been measured or sampled, and the right-hand side can be computed. We can only compute the sum of evaluations of the Fourier transform on the left-hand side. But now we take out the value for L equals 0 over here, so and multiply by h to the n. Then we find that f hat of xi is evaluated as the sum we have over here times h of n minus all the other terms that are over here. So that's the one we might want to compute. And this is the error, if you want. Okay, now we assume that f is omega band limited. Then if the absolute value of omega, and I take n equals 1 at this point. If the absolute value of psi is larger than omega, then we don't need to compute it, because since f is omega band limited, we have that f hat of psi is equal to 0. Now, if the absolute value of psi is smaller than omega, then if we can make sure that all these evaluations that we have over here lie outside of the range of minus omega to omega, then this is in fact 0. And well, that just means that we can compute f hat of psi just by computing this sum over here. Okay, let me show you what that means. This is the range of minus omega to omega. Of course, for the red crosses over here, if we want to compute the Fourier transform outside of that range, of course, everything's zero. So that's readily evaluated as zero. Now, for the simplest case, let's assume we want to compute the Fourier transform for psi equals zero, so at this point over here. Then, looking again at the sum over here, the next evaluation to the right would be at 2 pi over h. So the error to the right would be given over here by f hat of 2 pi over h if psi is equal to zero. So if 2 pi over h is larger or equal to omega, then that will be zero. And of course, all the other evaluations will be zero as well, because they're even further to the right. Okay, that's great. Now let's go to the left. So the left neighbor is located at minus 2 pi over h. So if that is smaller or equal to minus omega, then again, that evaluation will be zero. Okay, great. And all the other evaluations will be zero as well. So essentially, if we have that 2 pi over h is larger or equal to omega, then we find that if 2 pi over h is larger or equal to omega, then we find that we can actually compute f hat of zero. Okay, because all that error term over here is completely gone, and that translates into the condition that the sampling rate h should be smaller than to smaller or equal to 2 pi over omega. Okay, so that's for evaluating the Fourier transform at zero. Now, if we want to be able to compute the Fourier transform everywhere inside the interval from minus omega to omega, that's a little bit more complicated. So let's assume we have some psi with in that interval. So the absolute value of psi is smaller or equal to omega. That means that psi definitely is larger or equal to minus omega. And of course, we want the right neighbor to be outside of the range from minus omega to omega. So minus omega, so psi plus 2 pi over h, which is larger than minus omega, plus 2 pi over h should be larger than omega, and that translates into the condition that h should be smaller than pi over omega. And you get exactly the same condition for the left-hand side, and I'm not going to detail about this. Okay, so we can conclude from that if f is omega band limited, and if f has been sampled on a grid with a step size smaller or equal, to pi over omega, then the Fourier transform of f is uniquely determined by the values of f on that grid. Because if psi is outside of minus omega to omega, it's zero, then f hat of psi is zero. If it's inside, we can actually compute its values by evaluating the sum. Okay, this theorem has been discovered several times. Probably the first one to write it down in readable form was Kotelnikov in 1933. And it was rediscovered by Shannon and Nyquist in around 1950, and then it was fairly often used, so that's why it's still called Shannon's sampling theorem, although it should rather be called the theorem by Shannon, Nyquist, and Kotelnikov. And by the way, also Wiener had some part in this. So all the big names in signal theory contributed to this theorem. Okay, the engineers have a very nice formulation of this. Because if we say that in a function is omega band limited, that in a sense means that the highest frequency that appears in that function is actually something like sine of omega x cosine of omega times x. Think of the Fourier series in this case. And then our condition that h should be smaller than pi over omega translates into the condition that we need to sample twice per period, or we need to sample with a double frequency, with double maximum frequency. So that's what you often hear when you talk to engineers. And also note that this is in S. When we go to distributions, what we have to do when we talk about periodic functions, then the smaller or equal translates into smaller. But it's valid anyway. Okay, so now let me formulate the theorem in several steps. Assume that F in S is omega band limited. Then, of course, first of all, we have that if the norm of psi, and I always think of when I'm thinking about Rn here, I'm always thinking about the infinity norm of psi. If the infinity norm of psi is larger than omega, then we have that f hat of psi is equal to zero, because f is omega band limited. If the norm of psi is smaller than omega and h is smaller than pi over omega, again, if we're in S, this is a smaller or equal to, then we have that f hat of psi can be computed from the values of f on the grid as it is here. And that now really means the trapezoidal rule is exact. If we write down the Fourier integral for f hat of psi, just discretize it using the trapezoidal rule, this is exactly what comes out. Okay, if we just want to compute the value of the Fourier transform at zero, then we can slightly, as we saw, we can slightly relax that condition, and we can even allow for h smaller than 2 pi over omega, then that's still valid. And just plugging in the definition of f hat of zero, we find that the integral over Rn f of x dx is, I think I made a mistake here. I think this is wrong. No, this is correct, but again, excuse me. But again, I forgot the factor of 2 pi over minus n over 2 over here. And of course, now you can delete the 2 pi minus n over 2 on both sides. Okay, and of course, this again means the integral over Rn f of x dx is not only similar, approximated by the sum over all k f of k times h, which would be given by the trapezoidal rule, but it actually is exactly that one over here. And I think I somehow forgot the h over n again. Sorry for that. So I'm not into constants. Okay. Then now another remark, the sampling theorem also holds for distributions, so it also holds for 2 pi periodic functions, but then we need to take smaller than rather than smaller or equal. So yeah, same conditions as before. So if you have two pi periodic functions that's omega band limited, then it's uniquely determined by its values on a grid, where the grid size, where the step size should be smaller than pi over omega. So that's it. Okay, now the question is, okay, now we found out that f hat, and thus, of course, also f is uniquely determined. So is there a direct reconstruction formula from the values on the grid? And yes, there is. Let h smaller than pi over omega, then f in and f in s, of course, omega band limited. Then we have that f of x is sum over all k, f of h times k, sinc of pi over h x minus h times k. And you can take the pi over h out. These two forms are common in the literature. And now, but the proof is now extremely simple because we've computed everything already. For psi, absolute value of psi smaller than zero, smaller than omega, excuse me, absolute value of psi smaller than omega, we have that f hat of psi is 2 pi to the minus, I did it for one. Well, let's do it for the n here. It doesn't make a difference anyway. For absolute value, norm of psi, infinity norm of psi smaller than omega, we have that f hat of psi can be computed as this sum over here. If psi is larger than zero, if the norm of psi is larger than omega, then f hat of psi is zero. So if we multiply over here with the characteristic function of minus omega to the n, or minus pi over h to the n, because pi over h is larger than zero, then this is valid for all psi, right? Because if psi is smaller than omega, then this is one, and we have the sum. If the absolute value of psi is larger than omega, then it's zero because the characteristic function is zero. Okay, so this is valid everywhere. So we can just simply get f by taking the inverse Fourier transform, and but the psi only appears here and here. And again, I mean, that's the characteristic function of minus pi over h to pi over h that we all, the inverse Fourier transform of that we already computed. That's the sinc function times pi over h times the argument times pi over h. Then there's the exponential over here that's just shifting the argument according to our computation rules. And we find that f of x can be explicitly computed from the values of f on the grid by taking that sinc sum we have over here. Okay, and that's just using the computation rules for the Fourier transform that we've used many times now. Okay, one more remark, or one more part of that theorem. Let f and g omega band limited, then we immediately find that f times g is 2 omega band limited. That's using the Fourier, the convolution theorem, and the remark before 4.6 about the support of the convolution of two functions. And so then if f times g is 2 omega band limited, then we can apply the apply Shannon, that means that the integral over Rn f times g of x is h to the nk in Zn f of k times h g of k times h. And that is true for h smaller than pi over omega. And let me just show you what I did. I just applied this rule over here with omega replaced by 2 omega. Okay, and again, of course, we find that the trapezoidal rule is exact. And this one is definitely more a remark. The sum can actually converge arbitrarily small, so it's not very nice. It's not a very nice task to actually compute this, but it can be sped up by choosing not h very similar to pi over omega, but if you take h much smaller than pi over omega, then you find that the series converges much faster, and maybe that's something you will prove in the exercises.